Hey everyone, it's Pastor Tony. I hope you tuned in last week. You know, we were talking about the parable of the sower. I pray that that was a great word for you. Today we're going to pick that up again in Luke chapter 8. And we're going to go back to verse 11, Luke 8, 11. And I just pray that you're having a blessed week. Thank you so much for tuning in. So we're reading Luke 8, verse 11, and again from the New King James Version. And it says here in verse 11, now the parable is this. This is Jesus giving an explanation about this parable about the sower. And he says here, the seed is the word of God. Verse 12, those by the wayside are the ones who hear. Then the devil comes and takes away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. Okay, so we read from the other parallel versions of this parable and in Matthew chapter 13 and also in Mark chapter 4. We're reading Luke's version here. And at first ground that the word of God was sown upon, that the enemy comes in and snatches it. And it's when people don't understand. And so we talked last week about the true cost of ignorance, and it does allow the enemy access into your life. You know, we mentioned that Hosea 4:6, my people are destroyed for the lack of knowledge. We talked about Isaiah 5:13, how my people go into captivity because they have no knowledge. Proverbs 4:7 says, with all they're getting, get understanding. You know, get wisdom is the principal thing. I shared with you Proverbs 8, a whole chapter on wisdom. So wisdom is important. Getting knowledge, getting understanding is so crucial, okay? Wisdom and understanding helps keep the enemy out. Please don't embrace ignorance, because ignorance allows the enemy access. Now, let's move on to verse 13. But the ones on the rock are those who, when they hear, receive the word with joy. And while these have no root, who believe for a while, and in a time of temptation, they fall away. So there's another ground. Remember, there are four grounds, four different types of heart, if you would, that the word of God is sown upon. And the condition of the heart is what Jesus is speaking here, the condition of the heart. The first one, they didn't understand. This one, they had issues. So what happens in ground number two, you have people, well, just think about sowing some seeds, some real seeds, okay, be it flowers, plants, or whatever. And if you have an area that you're sowing in and there's a bunch of rocks and you don't clear away the rocks, the seed cannot take root because of the presence of the rocks. Well, the rocks really represent heart issues. It represents bitterness. It represents fear. It represents unforgiveness. It represents doubt. It represents the pain of the past. And so those things, because we don't want anyone to touch it, we don't want to admit it to anyone, we don't even want to acknowledge it, we think that we got it nice, good, and hidden, that everything is okay. We go sit in church, or you go to a great conference and the speaker is amazing. You can even read a book. You're listening to the Bible on audio, but it's not getting into your heart because you're still allowing the presence of all those things that God said get rid of. That's why forgiveness is so important. We have to learn to forgive people. And see, forgiving people doesn't mean I'm okay with what they did to me. I'm not that. That's not what it means at all. I know sometimes we think it is. If I forgive them, then that means I'm okay with it. And that means I'm this. No, that's not what it's saying at all. When I forgive people, it means I'm keeping what they did out of my heart and I can move on. That's literally what it means. It frees me up. It frees me up. Because if I walk around in unforgiveness, I'm imprisoning myself. And I've learned to just not to put certain value on the things that people do to me. I choose how I extend value towards certain things. And so as people say things and do things or they come up short, I choose to walk in forgiveness. In forgiveness. Okay, verse 14. Now the ones that fall among thorns are those who, when they have heard, go out and are choked with cares, riches, and pleasures of life, and bring no fruit to maturity. So there's evidence in ground number three, okay? They hear the word of God, and all of a sudden it sprouts up a little bit, it's doing pretty good, but what happens, it gets choked. The word of God can be choked. You say, how can the word of God be choked? Well, right here it says here with cares and riches. Well, first one is cares. You know, another word for cares in Greek, you know, which this was the original language, is distractions. You know, I've had to learn that, you know, not to allow things to distract me. You know, I remember like, I like cars, okay? I like fast cars, you know? You know, some people like luxury cars. I like cars. You give me a V12 and I'm happy, okay? But I can easily allow a new car model to come out and it's more than I can afford and I just have to have it. It'll distract me, okay? And then I go ahead and buy the car. You know what? I got a better example for you. You go to a car dealership. You can only afford, let's take a BMW. You can only afford a 3 Series. But somehow or another, they convince you that you can afford that 5 Series. and you want a nicer car, so you go ahead and you buy that upgrade, okay? But you fail to remember that that car, that upgrade, is going to cost more, but so does insurance. Probably so does the maintenance and upkeep. And all of a sudden now you got to work probably some, got to work extra overtime, a little bit of something just to pay for that. And so then that's when the cares come in. And all of a sudden now you can't get to the work. You can't get to Bible study anymore because you got to work overtime. You can't go to Sunday because Sunday service because you're so tired from working all week. Oh, I need to take a break. The cares of the world can choke the word of God. So really what I encourage people in my church and the churches we work with here locally and overseas is that you have to learn to better manage your life. The best way to manage your life is to learn to manage yourself. You have to learn to manage you. And so if I can become aware and make definite decisions and get some goals in place and plans and really get a clear vision for my life, because here's the thing that a clear vision does. It creates firm boundaries. The clearer the vision, the firmer the boundaries. I even teach this in marriage workshops, you know, helping families get a family vision. What is your family all about? And automatically, you know, boundaries will appear. So here's something, okay. Scripture says, without a vision, a people perish. That's old school King James. Proverbs 28:19, I believe. No, 29:18, I believe. So here's the thing. So without a vision, a people perish, okay? Literally perish means cast off restraint or they don't have boundaries, you know? I think the New Living Translation said people run wild. So with ground number three, really what we want to do is that we want to get a clear vision of God's purpose for our life. You know, sit down with your spouse and talk about what your goals, your plans, and dreams are, not only for the immediate, but also the intermediate range, you know, maybe 2 years out, but then get a long-term plan. What are you going to do after the kids are adults and they've gone into heaven? So here's what we have to look at, too, to help prevent this ground number three for the cares for overtaking us. We just got to plan better. Get a focus. I mean, get focused. And what is it you're on this planet to do? And just because something is on sale, you don't have to go buy it. You don't have to. You'll be amazed at how much you can do without, you know. Frequently, my wife and I work overseas and you know, there's always a temptation to buy stuff, you know, especially if we have downtime in the airport. We're on a, you know, 5-hour layover. You're just kind of walking around and you can be tempted. Nope. You got to have a plan. So when you got a long-term vision, that creates firm boundaries. And that really will help here in ground number three, okay? So it says here, and they go out and are choked with the cares, riches, and pleasures of life and bring no fruit to maturity. That's the other thing, too. We got to finish well. You know, Jesus said this. This is how we glorify God, that we bring forth fruit and the fruit remains. He said that in John chapter 15. Read that in verse 8 and also in verse 16, okay? We want, not only did we bring forth much fruit, but he wants it to remain. Now, unfortunately for a lot of us, the cares of this world, you know, we try to put our kids in every kind of sports program, you know, every kind of, you know, art and crafts. And we have so much we try to do. We try to cram it all in. You know, I heard years, many years ago, he talked about the rat race. And then one guy joked and said, at the end of the day, you're still a rat. And so you really have to find your purpose and what God created you to do. Stay in your lane, run your race, just stay significant, just become significant right there in your lane. You don't have to compete with anybody else. You don't even have to compare yourself with anyone else. Be uniquely you. Discover the authentic person that God created you to be and move towards that. That will really help get rid of ground number three, where that won't be an issue for you. Ground number four says, but the ones that fell on the good ground are those who, having heard the word with a noble and good heart, keep it and bear fruit with patience. And that's my prayer for you guys, too, is that you will receive the word of God, receive and graft the word with meekness, bring forth fruit, and that fruit shall remain. It says here in 15, these are those that fall on good ground. So you got a purpose to become good ground. So how do you do that? Ground number one, people that don't understand. Ground number two, people that have heart issues, bitterness, unforgiveness, fear, and doubt. Ground number three, you're getting choked by the cares of this world. You're just probably doing just too much. Prune some stuff, scale it back. And so you can become good ground, bring forth just this hundredfold return, just this abundance of fruit, and you bring it forth with patience. God bless you all. Can't wait to talk to you next week.